And good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to In Business. And our guest today is renowned cardiologist, Dr. Michelle Friday from Our Lady of Bellefonte Hospital. And we'll be back to talk with Dr. Friday about her and about what she's into. And she doesn't want to be nervous, so I'm not going to let her be. We'll be back in a minute. This is the OLBH Green and Beacon Media Network.
Your heart, it needs special care. The cardiology team at Our Lady of Bellefonte Hospital specializes in chest pain, heart disease, irregular heartbeats, congestive heart failure, and more. From prevention, detection, and treatment, including cardiac catheterization, balloon angioplasty, and stent placement, our team is helping patients find the perfect rhythm. Visit bonsecur.com to learn more.
At Carmen Funeral Home for more than 100 years, the original mission of the firm hasn't changed. They've always intended to provide the best and most professional services complemented by the finest products. Carmen Funeral Home, people serving people since 1913, from pre-need to final arrangements. Carmen Funeral Home.
Are you an adult looking for a new career? A high school senior ready for a new and exciting journey? No matter your education goals, we have a path to get you there. We have lots of programs to help you get a high-paying job quickly or work toward a bachelor's degree. Take advantage of the state's lowest tuition, outstanding training programs for jobs in your area, and online classes. Enroll now, Ashland Community and Technical College. Higher education begins here.
Our guest today, Dr. Michelle Friday, a cardiologist from OLBH. And Dr. Friday, before we get into the hard stuff, tell me a little bit about where you're from and where you went to school, family, whatever you want to talk about.
Okay, I'm originally from Grenada in the Caribbean. My mother's Scottish and my father was Grenadian. He was a surgeon in Grenada. I went to medical school in Grenada and did my training, medical training and cardiology training in New Jersey. And then did my interventional cardiology training at Beth Israel in Manhattan, in New York.
Right.
And then left New York and the New Jersey area to come work in Kentucky. I worked in London, Corbin area for 4 years, and I've been here for the past...
Baptist down there? Baptist Hospital?
Yes. And I've been here for the last 10 years.
Right.
My husband, Vincenzo Frisola, he's an architect. And I have two children, a 14-year-old daughter, Vanessa, and my son, Enzo, who's 11.
That in itself tells me all I need to know, that you have to stay on your toes.
I definitely do. It's really a juggle, juggling work and family and patients and just educating the community.
And doing magazines.
Exactly.
You know,
educating the community.
That's right. And normally when they reach 14, they're about 25, and they know all they need to know.
So. Yes.
And in true disclosure, Dr. Friday has been inside my heart. She did a catheterization. Actually, I didn't have to have anything done, but because I was having this, it's carotid surgery, but there's a name for it.
Yeah.
You know it, I don't know it.
Carotid endarterectomy.
There you go. We have one of those. And I did not require open heart. I didn't have any problems there. And Dr. Friday released me to have the surgery. So I do want to tell you that she is outstanding, has an outstanding bedside manner, and she is extremely professional. But the part I like, you ask her a question, she gives you an answer. And that's important. February is Heart Month. You want to tell me why that is?
Well, as you know, heart disease is the number one killer for both men and women in the United States and worldwide. Still, many people think that it is just a man's disease. Yet, heart disease kills more women than lung cancer and breast cancer combined. And so, more than half women don't realize that heart disease is probably their number one threat. And so February was a month designed to alert patients and to alert people that it is important to realize that women are at risk, high risk for having heart disease. So there's the Wear Red Day, which is the first Friday in February, where women are encouraged to wear red to send the message to other women that heart disease is the number one killer for women.
Right. Well, I wore my red on the third Wednesday, but hey, who am I? And I actually wore red on the first Friday because I thought everybody was supposed to.
Exactly. And we are taking this celebration and campaign, awareness campaign, through the month of February at OLBH, Our Lady of Belfont. On the 8th, we had Wine, Dine, and Design, where I discussed with the participants their risk factors and what they could do to reduce their risk of having a heart attack. Today, we're having a yoga session where we will try to encourage people to exercise, to commit to be fit for your heart.
Do you do yoga?
I will be doing it this afternoon. Yes. And that is at the Belfont Pavilion between 5 and 7. And next week, we actually have a Commit to be Fit community fair where people can go and learn about their risk factors and what they can do to reduce their tendency to have heart disease.
So let's back up a second here. What are considered risks for risk factors for heart disease besides being overweight, diabetic like me?
Well, I think you've answered the question. There's several risk factors, and people need to know their numbers. I think it's important for people to know whether they have diabetes, what are their blood sugars like, whether they have high cholesterol levels over 200, whether they have high blood pressure, what is their blood pressure? If it's one over 140, over 80, they need to be doing something about it. Whether they're obese, whether they're physically inactive. And then there are other risk factors that they can't do anything about, such as family history, stress. But there is the number one preventable cause of heart disease that people can do something about, and that's tobacco smoking.
So, have you ever smoked in your life?
No, I haven't. But I do smoke through secondhand smoking.
Yes.
And third-hand smoking when I have patients smoking or other people smoking close to me in my environment. That's secondhand smoking. Or even sitting at a ball game where someone had been smoking at home and they come and they're sitting next to me. I can smell the smoke off their clothes, and that's third-hand smoking.
And
so I have been exposed.
And I can tell you the worst place in the world for that are the elevators at the hospital.
Yes.
Folks grab one before they come in, and then they're in there with you.
Exactly.
Yes.
And it is just as risky to be exposed to secondhand smoking and also to third-hand smoking.
I will. One of the things that I'm proud about me is, while I have never been able to control my weight, I don't really know why, because we basically try to eat very fit, but being disabled to where I can't walk, it makes a big difference. But I quit smoking February the 5th, 1995. I smoked 4 packs a day.
Congratulations.
I came to the hospital.
Yeah.
And my blood pressure was like 250 over 120, and my sugar numbers were out of control. So everything was diagnosed that day.
Yes.
I'm sure I had sugar well before that.
Exactly.
But I was in there 4 days, and when I went out, I thought, I haven't smoked in 4 days. So when I went home, my wife and daughters completely detailed the inside of the car, got rid of all the packages, all the extras, and I have not smoked a cigarette. That'd be what, 95, 05, 15, 23 years.
It takes amazing resolve to do it, but if people understand the risk of heart disease as well as lung cancer, COPD, you know, needing to be on long-term oxygen, you know, we hope that more people can do like you did and try to come.
Well, I just quit. I didn't even use patches or anything. Before we take a break, I have a few more questions here. When we talk about heart disease, let's talk a little bit about what the symptoms of heart disease are.
That's a very good question. Most people think, like in the movies, when someone's having a heart attack, they're having gut wrenching, chest pain. So some people don't have that. You know, some women particularly, or men, may have neck pain, pain between the shoulder blades, pain down the arms. They may have epigastric pain, nausea, vomiting, or they may just break out into a cold sweat while they're doing things,
right,
and not really realize what's going on. Or people may just feel fatigue and just feel overall tired. So the symptoms vary. Most people have chest pain, but it's so important to realize that not everyone has chest pain. Some people may just have chest discomfort or chest pressure, and because it's not pain, they say they can't be having a heart attack,
right,
and so they don't seek help.
Denial's the biggest problem.
The important thing is, if you're having a heart attack, 25% of people don't make it to the hospital because they have a heart attack at home and their heart goes into lethal rhythm that they have sudden cardiac death at home. So it's really important to understand what the symptoms are.
I know that I've had many friends who denied and barely, and some didn't make it and some barely made it. And, you know, and then you're in a rush for surgery and things get so accelerated, the stress is unbelievable.
Absolutely, yes.
So prevention of heart disease, of course, is the best way to not have it. So talk about ways. I know you would want to keep your triglycerides down and cholesterol, and but what are the other things you can do to prevent heart disease?
Number one, stop smoking, as we discussed. Number two, eat healthy. And by eating healthy, I mean low-fat diet, low sugar. I'm going to say something about sugar because people in this area drink a lot of sugar. And they don't realize that they're actually eating sugar by drinking sugar. And so they figure, well, I'm not eating much, but yet I don't understand why my sugars are still high. And you must understand that a man should have no more than 36 grams of sugar a day. A woman should have no more than 24 grams of sugar a day. Yet one soda could have 48 grams of sugar.
Right.
So in one soda, most people are having, you know, double or triple the amount of sugar that they should be having in one day. So just becoming aware of these things, lowering your salt, sodium, managing your blood pressure, managing your cholesterol, realizing that, you know, you have a strong family history. Your brother had a heart attack when he was in his 40s or 30s. You have a sister who's had a heart attack at a young age. Your parents had heart attacks at a young age. You've had sudden cardiac death. You have relatives that have had open heart surgery, stents or heart attacks. If you can recognize that and then seek attention with your doctor, go to your doctor, find out whether you have these risk factors, and once you know whether you have them, then try to get them treated. And just becoming more active if you can. You said you have so sometimes there are issues that people cannot be very active, but definitely just trying to eat, I say, from scratch, lowering processed foods, lowering fast foods in the diet, and eating more lean meats, vegetables, fruit, and beans.
And fresh, not processed.
Fresh, not processed.
We're going to take a break and play some commercials, and we'll be back to talk to Dr. Friday some more here on the OLBH Green of Beacon Media Network.
Name, new address. Sharp Accounting and Insurance, now at 1200 Diedrich Boulevard, Russell, Kentucky, in the former AAA building. Call Philip Sharp today for your auto, home, business insurance needs at 606-324-0696 or Sharp Accounting at 606-324-5655 for your IRS, taxes, accounting, and payroll services.
Everything about Stultz Pharmacy is special because everything they do is aimed at pleasing you, their customer. Low-priced prescription medications, their unsurpassed selection of over-the-counter medications, drop-off and pick-up, drive-through window, free blood pressure screenings, free delivery, large selection of greeting cards, collectibles, Yankee candles, and gift items for all occasions. Just a few of the things that Stultz Pharmacy offers their customers every day. Stultz Pharmacy, with locations in Greenup, Flatwoods, and Wheelersburg. More than you expect from a pharmacy.
Stultz Pharmacy.
Are you an adult looking for a new career? A high school senior ready for a new and exciting journey? No matter your education goals, we have a path to get you there. We have lots of programs to help you get a high-paying job quickly or work toward a bachelor's degree. Take advantage of the state's lowest tuition, outstanding training programs for jobs in your area, and online classes. Enroll now, Ashland Community and Technical College. Higher education begins here.
Welcome to Bellefonte Animal Clinic. Dr. Amy Bess is a licensed veterinarian treating dogs, cats, and other small animals. Your pet's health and well-being are very important, and Dr. Bess and staff will take every step to give your pet the best possible care. Bellefonte Animal Clinic is a full-service animal clinic and will take routine wellness cases as well as medical, surgical, and dental issues. Dr. Amy Bess, Bellefonte Animal Clinic, 1500 Kenwood Drive, Russell. Call 606-836-9933.
Dr. Michelle Friday from OLVH, and she's been here 10 years. It was strange you brought up Corbin. I used to live in Whitley City.
Yes.
I ran the paper there in 2004 and 5, so that was about the time you were down there. Mm-hmm. So,
yes.
We're going to go back and talk. Dr. Friday is a cardiologist. That's what she does. She's from Grenada, right?
Grenada. Yes.
You know, there's a movie called Heartbreak Ridge. It's
about the Grenada.
Have you seen it?
Yes, about Grenada.
That's right. And there was a medical student that they actually went to save. So it was, I thought that was interesting when you said that.
I was in medical school at that time. And I hope no one checks the dates because then it tells you a little bit about my age. But just wanted to tell you how I got to Ashland.
Okay.
Kentucky. I came to visit some other physicians here. It's just a good story, I think. And while I was visiting with them, I was just sort of standing out in the street, and one of the persons from the administration came up to speak to the doctors who were working at OLBH, and I was introduced, and he said to me, "Would you like to come and work at Bellefonte?" And I said, "Well, I have a job, you know. I'm not really interested," but something told me to give him my business card.
Right.
So I walked over to the card, got my card, and brought it back to him. And on Monday, this was on Saturday, on Monday, Bellefonte gave me a call and asked me whether I'd been interested in coming. Of course, I had a job already and I was working, but they were persistent with saying that they really wanted to start a heart program at Bellefonte. And they knew that I was an interventional cardiologist, which is a cardiologist that puts stents in and deals with people coming in right away with heart attacks, what we call cold hearts.
Right.
And so they actually pursued me for a couple months. And I knew that I wanted to stay in Kentucky. I already had two kids. And I thought it would be a great opportunity to start a new program and to do something fresh.
Right.
And I love the Ashland area when we came to visit.
And new is always nice. You get
you get
to impress your ideas and things of that nature as well. So
absolutely.
So you're here, but you mentioned that magic word stents, and stents tend to scare people when you talk about them. I have three stents, but mine are in my legs, not in my heart. It's anywhere plaque can build in a vein. And they stented my neck, I suppose. I guess when they do a carotid procedure, they put something in there.
Or they can just open up and...
I was 98% blocked. So I was standing at the door of a stroke or death. And With that said, I'm eternally grateful that Dr. Orman Kadood,
yes,
insisted. But you know you're in trouble, Dr. Friday, when they call you and say, can you go to the hospital right now?
Yes.
Yeah. Because they've done an MR.
Those are words patients don't necessarily want to hear.
Right. And the other thing I wanted to say that we've moved on from, if you think you're having a heart attack, go to the hospital. Don't, or go somewhere, but don't stay home thinking it's going to go away.
Well, as I said, 25% of people don't get to the hospital because they wait too long at home,
right,
and have sudden cardiac death at home. But if you think you're having a heart attack, I would recommend taking an aspirin,
right,
calling 911, and absolutely not driving yourself to the hospital because you can have an accident on the road. And when the ambulance comes, they can start giving you life-saving therapy,
right,
in the ambulance.
Right.
Now, once you get to the hospital, there's a mad rush. There's something called the door-to-balloon time on getting a patient to the cath lab. Patient comes into the emergency room, either in the ambulance, we would know from an EKG that they're already having a heart attack, or the minute they get to the ER, they have an EKG that tells us that the patient's having a heart attack.
Right.
And so at that point in time, the interventional cardiologist, which is the cardiologist that puts stents in, calls a cold heart, and that activates personnel to come in no matter what time of day it is or night, 2 o'clock in the morning, 4 o'clock in the morning. They need to get into the hospital very quickly, and we need to take that patient to the cath lab where we can then put them on the table, either prep their groins or their wrists, get to the heart with little tubes up to the heart, take pictures. Usually there's a big camera above the patient where we can see what's going on. And then through that process, we're able to feed little tubes into their heart, balloons,
mm-hmm,
with stents on them, and deploy stents that open up the artery. So the next question is, what is heart disease? And as you all know, the heart is an organ probably about the size of your fist that stays in your chest. And this little miracle organ pumps blood to the tip of your head down to your big toe. And if you're not getting blood in any of these areas, the body in that area will die. So it's very important to have blood pumping. And if you're having a heart attack, basically the arteries on the surface of the muscle are closing down. They have blockages in them, and so that the heart in that area is not getting blood, and so it stops moving. And then it gets irritable, and it can go into a bad rhythm. So it's really important, or if it doesn't go into a bad rhythm, it forms scar tissue and your heart muscle gets weak, and that's a whole host of other problems. So it's really important to get in, get a stent in there, and open the artery in the right patient, of course.
Certainly. Now, let's talk about the cath lab. My first visit to the cath lab was the old cath lab.
Yes.
And they put a stent, actually a balloon the first time and a stent the second time, in my left leg to promote circulation because I have this capacity to hold plaque.
Yes.
Then they moved it outside to a trailer, which people got all tore up about, I heard. But at the same time, it was a fine,
Well, I must say something about that mobile cath lab, you know. That mobile cath lab allowed us to put in a new state-of-the-art $1.2 million new cath lab, but that mobile lab was also a state-of-the-art piece,
yes,
of equipment, you know.
Yes.
So it was small, but it's sort of a bridge. It was a bridge cath lab while we were waiting to upgrade our cath lab. It had all the amenities of our current cath lab, different equipment, but still very good equipment. So people were a little bit upset, maybe one or two.
Upset's
I probably
the wrong
had
word.
One yeah,
question. Just question,
yeah,
what was going on.
I actually did not have any problem with most of my patients. I think just one,
right,
patient questioned it. But, you know, we would not put a patient at risk.
No.
You know? We're here
not
in
at
the
all.
Business to save lives.
Not to create,
yes,
dilemmas, right. So I do want to point out I wore red today in honor of Heart Month, and Dr. Friday did not. So I wanted to point this out. Oh,
actually,
she's got
I have a red scarf on with hearts on it.
She always has something on. What else we want to talk about?
Well, we talked about the our new cath lab, which I'm really excited about.
Now, I want to say that I want to compliment whoever set up the new cath lab.
Absolutely.
Because they have a bed in there long enough for people that are 6'4". When I first went in there, Dr. Kadood had to push the thing down on my belly, and my head was hanging back like this, and they had to push the trash can over and put a board on it, and I'm not kidding, because I was hanging off that table. So.
Well, I've not had that problem, but it is a thin table, and it needs to be so that you can radiation can penetrate through it.
Sure.
And as I said, right now it's a state-of-the-art piece of equipment. At Bellefonte, we have 4 cardiologists. We have Dr. Rhodes, who's been in the community forever. He's our grandfather of cardiology in Ashland. And then we have Dr. Prasad, who also does caths in the cath lab. And last July, I had the pleasure of welcoming my new partner, Dr. Linsenmeyer, George Linsenmeyer, who's also an interventional cardiologist. So we are a team of 4 cardiologists now at Bellefonte. We have a full team. We have quite a team of mid-levels that have a lot of experience in heart disease and the treatment. So I think that we're well poised at this point to offer patients the best, in heart disease.
You use physician's assistants to visit patients in the hospital too?
It's sort of a double visit, because usually what happens is the mid-levels would go around while the physicians are doing procedures and just to get things moving at the beginning of the day. There's discussion with the mid-levels throughout the day about the care of the patient. And then probably by midday, the physician then goes ahead and rounds on the patients again. And in most cases, the mid-level will go back around just to make sure that the patient understands what they need to be on after having a stent, what medications, and explains the importance of patients continuing on medications after discharge.
Yeah, I'm the Plavix king. 2 baby aspirin at night and a Plavix in the morning.
Excellent.
You have one more time we want to talk about, before we take our final break, we want to talk about FIT.
Commit to be fit.
Yeah, there it is.
Yes.
And that is when?
That is next Wednesday at the Bellefonte Pavilion between 5 and 7. And I encourage the community of Ashland to come. As I said, Ashland, Kentucky is in the top 10 unhealthy states in the United States. West Virginia is number 1 heart disease, which is just across the river. That spills over into Ashland. We want people to come to this health fair and to see what it takes. They can get their blood pressure checked, they can get their cholesterol checked and sugars checked at that point in time. We're going to raise the awareness of risk factors. Dr. Prasad is going to speak a little bit about cardiac testing, and I will speak about patients having heart attacks and women and heart disease. Also, there would be some tips for healthy eating. There will be some a live demonstration of healthy cooking. There will be healthy food display. There will be a table telling people to avoid sugary drinks. We're really trying to get that. A no tobacco table where the staff there can help people quit smoking, at least point them in the right direction, either through classes or getting to a physician, to either go on Chantix or to nicotine patches and so on. So I'm very excited about this fair, because I feel that in Ashland, where we're quite unhealthy with heart disease, that the participant will be better educated and better able to help themselves. I want to say this. There's a lot of bad news. Yes, heart disease is the number one killer, but if we do something to reduce our risk factors, we can actually reduce heart disease by 80% by taking care of reduction of risk factors. I mean, this is huge news. This is good news. That means that if we are proactive and we do something about it, we can reduce our risk of dying of a heart attack.
We'll be back with Dr. Friday for our final segment in a minute on the OLBH Green at Beacon Media Network at greenatbeacon.com.
as careful as you are, and Kurt Robinson State Farm Insurance in Flatwoods reminds you to drive carefully at all times. For all your insurance needs, auto, home, life, and health, contact Kurt Robinson Insurance with over 28 years as a State Farm agent. Phone 836-3011. Auto quotes available 24/7 at 836-3011. Kurt Robinson Insurance, 1114 Belfont Road in Flatwoods.
Like a good neighbor, State Farm is there.
We are based around creating events, creating exposure, creating that opportunity for the athlete that wants to play at the next level. The biggest thing that I've been able to grasp so far, what differs us from any other tournaments, from the perspective of the parents, the girls, the coaches, is everything that's coming into the tournament itself.
At Meredith Chiropractic, you will enjoy state-of-the-art chiropractic facilities and discover the true wellness lifestyle. Dr. Terry Meredith is a member of Great Doctors of Chiropractic and has helped many in the Ashland area experience natural healing without surgery or drugs. If you're looking for a skilled chiropractic doctor, visit MeredithChiropractic.com, call 329-8158, or visit Dr. Meredith's office at 2120 Carter Avenue in Ashland.
Your heart, it needs special care. The cardiology team at Our Lady of Belfont Hospital specializes in chest pain, heart disease, irregular heartbeats, congestive heart failure, and more. From prevention, detection, and treatment, including cardiac catheterization, balloon angioplasty, and stent placement, our team is helping patients find the perfect rhythm. Visit bonsecur.com to learn more.
Hank Bond, along with Dr. Michelle Friday. And Dr. Friday, I want to tell you that you have become one of my all-time favorite guests today.
Oh, thank you very much.
Very prepared, dressed a whole lot better than me. But, you know, that's because she's got the red scarf on. Dr. Friday, let's summarize up our points. So we talked earlier about how to survive an MR or an MI, but you need to be sure that you don't put it off.
Absolutely. We need to know the scope of this disease. It is the number one killer. Most women are afraid of dying of breast cancer and lung cancer, but more people die of heart disease than breast cancer and lung cancer combined. We have to realize that over 600,000 people die yearly of heart disease. Every minute, someone is dying of a heart attack, and every 40 seconds, someone's having a heart attack. We really need to realize, and especially women, because women tend to be caregivers. They don't have the time to go to the doctor. They don't have the time to prioritize their health. So they stay at home. They're taking care of children, grandchildren, and they put off looking after themselves. Women really need to prioritize their health, because in doing so, you ensure that you're around to take care of grandchildren for many, many years. So if you're having that nagging feeling, whether it's pressure every time you're making up your bed or while you're running the sweeper, you know, you're getting a little bit of pain between the shoulder blades, or you feel a little short of breath, just doing something like washing the dishes, which you normally didn't do, and it goes away with rest. Many people say, well, I didn't do anything about it because I stopped what I was doing and it went away. But exactly that. If you're having symptoms when you're exerting yourself that goes away with rest, then that is a warning sign that you have blockages in your arteries. And you certainly don't want to wait until you're having a heart attack. And women need to realize that they don't always have crushing chest pain. Anything from pressure, discomfort. I tell patients anything from your nose to your belly button, front and back, that comes on with exertion, goes away with rest, could be coming from your heart. And certainly just symptoms like fatigue, tiredness, dizziness, having chest discomfort, pain between the shoulders, down the arms, shortness of breath, you need to get it checked out. You know, you need to go to your doctor. And if your doctor does not take you seriously because, one, they think you're a woman and you can't possibly have heart disease, my hope is that after this talk that you know that is the number one cause of heart disease, the number one cause of death in women, and that you ask questions. You will ask your physician, I would like to have some tests. I believe that I have heart disease. My mother died at 45, or, you know, you because you're more knowledgeable now, you can give this information to your physician and say, I would like to have a stress test, or I would like to have some tests that would show whether I have risk factors for having heart disease. And once you know what your risk is, then that pretty much gives you an idea if you're at higher risk of having heart disease, and take your symptoms seriously, you know?
I noticed one of our notes that there's $200 billion a year spent on healthcare. Care.
So this is a big deal for an economic burden for the United States. About $600 billion is spent in hospitalization of patients, in medication costs, and in lost productivity, patients not showing up to work. Now, what happens if you have a heart attack? As you have one heart attack, your heart can get a little bit weaker if you've not gotten to the hospital in time. And with each successive heart attack, the heart muscle gets weaker. And as that heart muscle gets weaker, then it doesn't do its job of pumping blood all around the body. And that could put you at risk for having congestive heart failure, where you get fluid on your lungs, mm-hmm. you get swelling in your ankles, you're short of breath with minimal exertion. And really, at that point in time, you don't feel like doing a lot. You know, your quality of life goes down. So to avoid all of that, congestive heart failure, to avoid weakening the heart muscle, we can help prevent having heart attacks, or certainly if you're having one, get to the hospital. And this is why in the cath lab, we try to get the patient onto the cath table, no matter what time of day or night, and opening up their arteries with a stent to allow blood to flow to the artery.
I know from personal experience that if you control your salt intake, eat fresh food, the fluid on your body will let itself out, and your swelling will go down. The problem that some of us have, the one here, is neuropathy also causes swelling, so you really never know what it is. So I take a lot of water pills and try to make sure that I'm eating right, and you know, that's really all you can do is do what you can do, but you shouldn't make it a priority, and that's what we do at our house. So
yeah. The other thing about salt and sugar is really knowing about hidden salt and hidden sugar. I mean, a slice of bread has sugar in it, and people wouldn't think so, you know? A can of soup has more salt in it than one person should have in a day, depending on the kind of...
Right.
So it's really about educating yourself, reading labels, understanding whether there's one or two portions, you know, in that serving, how many servings they are in that item, and understanding what your limit should be in terms of sugar per day, 36 grams for a man, 24 for a woman, and 1,500 milligrams of salt in the diet if you have high blood pressure.
Which is basically 2 teaspoons, and the problem people have with that is they don't recognize, as you say with sugar, it's the same with salt. If you eat canned green beans, you're going to have a lot of salt. And some soups have 1,000 just in one serving, and the can's 2 servings.
Absolutely.
And eat the whole can, you've actually gone over your day.
Absolutely.
So that's why we make our own fresh minestrone soup, and minimize, we use low-salt vegetable juice to make it. And, you know, it's a concerted effort. It's, you know, and unfortunately our society has sped up so much that it's easier for you to hit McDonald's on the way home than it is to go cook at home. I'm not saying that you do that.
I've been there myself. I understand that. You know, life gets busy, so you pick up the easiest thing for the children. And I've realized that, you know, I'm not doing my family a favor. I'm not doing my children a favor by picking up fast food. And there could be a lot of economic backlash by me just saying that we shouldn't do fast food because that's what gives people jobs, people working in these fast food places. But really, if we're trying to build a healthy nation, a heart-healthy nation, we need to start eating from scratch. More home-cooked foods and avoiding sugary drinks, drinking more water, and certainly looking at sodium. Sodium is in everything that's processed because that's how it
keeps
it
its flavor.
It.
Yes, yeah. And it keeps its flavor.
For a long time, exactly.
Dr. Friday, we'd like to thank you for being on with us today. I know that you are going to go back to work now, and soon you'll have your program at the... Now, where is it going to be at the Pavilion, the last thing we're doing?
Commit to Be Fit for Your Heart program is actually next Wednesday, the 28th of February, between 5 and 7.
5 and 7.
Today, we have a yoga class, which anyone is welcome to come. Just wear red. So I'll have to go get something red to wear for that.
Wear your scarf.
Just get people into being fit and active. Thank you very much.
Dr. Michelle Friday from Our Lady of Bellefonte Hospital and Grenada as her starting place. Do you live here in Russell or Iceland?
I live in Russell.
In Russell.
Yes.
Do your children go to school here?
Yes, they go to Russell.
Excellent.
We're very much part of the community.
Yes.
My husband's in Rotary. He tries to get on every board that he can get onto.
Sure.
I'm at Bellefonte and very happy. It's a good group of people at Our Lady of Bellefonte.
Certainly
and,
is.
There are people there that really care about patient and put patient care as top priority. I think generally in this community, we have good medical care. I mean, between the two hospitals that are here, we have good medical care, and I'm very fortunate to be here and to be employed by Bellefonte Hospital.
We won't have a program next week because it is the middle of the regional basketball tournament, but we will return on the 7th day of March. That will allow us to get a little rest from 6 nights of driving to Moorhead and back. And there is processed food involved in that, Dr. Friday. I will promise you.
Quick food is processed.
That's right. It's hard to eat fresh when you're driving 2.5 hours, you know. So anyway, Dr. Friday, thank you so much for being with us. And you can join us again here next week or in March for In Business on the OLBH Green at Beacon Media Network.